So, first class on MOSFETs, the analog way. Okay. So, what is a MOSFET actually made of? MOSFET means we are actually studying field effect transistor action only. This time, not with a junction based device but with a MOS based device. MOS, metal oxide and semiconductor. So you can see that there are three people here. One is a metal, one is a oxide and one is a semiconductor. Now this device came pretty much late, you know, it came very late. BJT was invented somewhere in the year 1947. It was the same year in which we got independence. And MOSFET came at least 20 years after that. Now the reason for that was that time we had the technology to grow one semiconductor on another semiconductor. We had the technology to grow one semiconductor on another semiconductor. That means we could grow p-type silicon on n-type silicon or n-type silicon on p-type silicon. But if you look at the names of this MOS, metal obviously stands for it is metallic. Oxide is an insulator. And semiconductor, as the name suggests, it has a conductivity somewhere between metal and insulator. Now the process of putting one metal on another metal, you all can recall, is called as electrolysis. It is called as electrolysis. But what is the method to put insulator on semiconductor? So this, we did not have this technology at that time, and that is the reason why, though we had the concept in mind, but we did not have the technology to actually do this. And that is the reason why this technology got delayed by a period of almost 20 to 25 years. Today, to make this structure, that is metal, oxide and semiconductor, that means first we start with semiconductor. On that, we sputter, the process is called as sputtering. That is oxide, and on oxide we do something called as RF sputtering, that is we put metal. Now here the structure of the MOSFET is somewhat like this. First is the MOS device. So out of this metal, oxide and semiconductor, we will be observing this field effect, that is FET part, slightly later. First we will observe only the MOS part. So the entire MOSFET analysis actually happens in two parts. First we observe the MOS, that is the MOS part, and second we observe the field effect transistor action. Like JFET, MOSFET is also a voltage controlled current device. That means voltage is controlling the current. What is the advantage of the MOSFET? The control is better and the device can be made smaller because junction is replaced by a MOS structure. Now, when it comes to a MOS device, here MOS means metal, oxide and semiconductor. But the question arises, which metal, which oxide and which semiconductor? So let us see first, the most commonly and used metal is aluminium, and it is very much abundantly available. But if you actually dope with metal, there can be contamination issues. That is the reason why we use something called as polysilicon, which is heavily negatively doped silicon. What is metal? Metal has got a very high concentration of electrons. So if we put n type of impurity in very much heavy concentrations in a silicon itself, then silicon starts behaving like metal. That is what we mean by polysilicon, and the doping concentrations are greater than 10 raised to 20 atoms per centimeter cube. Then if you want even higher conductivity, then we can have a combination of metal and polysilicon that is called as polyside. So you can see I have written here, it has got very heavy negatively doped silicon. Same concentrations are greater than 10 raised to 20 plus metal. So you can make silicon only behave as metal by doping it with, by heavily doping it with negative impurities. Then next comes oxide. So the most common oxide is called as silicon dioxide. That is called as SiO2. Then if you want to use this same MOSFET in high power applications, then this oxide might break down. And that is why in power MOSFETs, which we will be looking at in our last chapter, that is power amplifiers, we use MOSFETs, structure is the same, only material is different. Instead of SiO2, we go for some other dielectric. And this is called as aluminium trioxide. Then, if you want, if the MOSFET, if you are trying to pass very high current also through the MOSFET, then the oxide has to be something else, that is tantalum pentoxide. And if you are planning to put this MOSFET in a very low power application like mobile phone or your smart watches, etc., then the oxide which we use is lithium oxide. So in between there was something called as lithium oxide batteries. Actually batteries are never made up of lithium oxide. The technology in the phone use was lithium oxide. As far as semiconductor is concerned, very simple. We have P silicon and we have N silicon. Please note that the P silicon concentration is written in terms of Na and the N silicon, negatively doped silicon, is called as Nd. That is simply because P silicon can accept one electron. That is why we say acceptor ion concentration. And N silicon can give one silicon. That is why it is called as donor ion concentration. So I want you to take this down without any colors. Just write it MOS device and show this bifurcation in your notebooks. And once you are done, please write done in the chat box. Here it is important to note these concentrations. Now I am expecting somebody to ask me why only this much? Why only this much concentration? Why not more? So actually what happens is that silicon has got 5 into 10 raised to 20 atoms per centimeter cube. That means in 1 centimeter cube of silicon, there are 5 into 10 raised to 20 atoms. Now, if I dope silicon with something more than this value, then impurity will not be in silicon. Silicon will be in the impurity. So we don't want that to happen. And that is why this value, if you see, it is 5 times lesser than this. This Nd is 5 times, so at the most you can go up to 10 raised to 20. And in regular or practical cases, we go up to 10 raised to 16 or 10 raised to 18. So these values are coming from this value, which is the number of atoms per centimeter cube in silicon. Any doubts, please ask. We are doing the fundamentals of the MOSFET and we need to see this the analog way. Our first experiment will also be based on this. So we will have to write us around 8 SPICE codes. Codes are similar, but results are slightly different. If you are done, please write done in the chat box. And if you want to ask a question, just raise your hand. I'll just take it here itself. So again, I am repeating, we are doing MOSFETs. And we are doing that in two parts. First, we will study MOS. Then we will see the FET action, and then we will combine both this to get our MOSFET device. Okay, good reach. Just for reference, Karthik, those EDC 1 notes which I had sent to you, please send it to everybody else also, so that if somebody wants to go a little bit back, they can always see those concepts. They will not be directly required, but yes, maybe, you know, once in a while we may have to look at it.
Sir, I will share that. I will share that.
Okay, so let's go ahead. The MOS structure. The next one is the MOS structure. Now, everybody will draw this MOS structure. Now, while drawing, you have to take care. So just wait before you draw this. The aluminium part should be moderate in size. SiO2 should be very thin in size. And P silicon should be the biggest. And P silicon should be the biggest. So please draw this structure like this. I will first explain it and give you 5 minutes to draw this thing. This is a box, basically. It's a MOS structure. So when we talk about MOS, we should also highlight on what is this, how the structure actually looks like. How much of metal, how much of oxide, and how much of semiconductor, and what are the sizes of this device. So here, the aluminium part is medium in size, SiO2 is the thinnest in size, and P silicon is the biggest in size. This part, Al, is metal, the oxide used is SiO2, and what we are calling as a semiconductor is P silicon. So semiconductor actually means, when we are saying the word semiconductor, we are actually referring to an extrinsic semiconductor. Or we are referring to a doped semiconductor. So don't, some students have a doubt, sir is saying semiconductor, then why is he doping it with P or N? So in all books, they write extrinsic semiconductor also as semiconductor. And out of this extrinsic can be two. Extrinsic can be two type, either p type or n type. We call it as psi or nsi. So here we cannot use both at the same time, and that is why we are using p silicon. Slowly, slowly, now you will understand that when the substrate is p type, we are referring to a nmos, and when the substrate is n type, we are referring to a PMOS, but slightly at a later stage. First, we will only look at the structure. Now, the actual values. So you can see that the metal is around 1 to 2 microns. SiO2 is around 10 to 100 angstroms. And the bulk is the biggest in size, that is 0.5. mm, that is around 500 microns. So p silicon is at least 500 times bigger than Al. And how much is 1 angstrom? So this 10 to 100 angstroms is called as TOX. That is the first parameter of the MOSFET, that is called as TOX. And TOX is called as gate oxide thickness. It is called as gate oxide thickness. Just for your reference, 1 angstrom is 10 raised to minus 10 meters, and 1 meter is 100 centimeters. That is why 10 raised to minus 8 centimeters. We don't have 1 meter long chips. Our chips are just somewhere, you know, in centimeters. We don't have something in meters. That is why the most common unit used is centimeters and not meters. So please draw this structure. Our entire frequency response depends on this MOS structure. And that is why we should know this structure very well. You must have come across FET and the terminals which you used to speak about is gate, drain, source and body. But in this structure, you can see only gate and body. Drain and source are missing. So they will come slightly at a later stage when we talk about the FET action. They will come slightly at a later stage when we talk about FET action. So purposely I am repeating, in this structure, drain and source are missing, will be added later. Karthik has completed drawing this structure, but I am sure many must have not completed it. So I'll wait for another 4 or 5 minutes. So moral of the story of this slide is that aluminium is medium in size. SiO2, that is the oxide layer, is very thin in size, very, very thin. And the biggest part of the MOSFET is P silicon. And the biggest part of MOSFET is P silicon. And just to reiterate, 1 angstrom is 10 raised to minus 10 meters, which is 10 raised to minus 8 centimeters. Just multiply 10 raised to minus 10 by 100, you will get 10 raised to minus 8 centimeters. Okay. Now we are going to again come back to this structure within 2 minutes. Now you can see here, in this is aluminium is metallic. Okay, so it has got mostly negative charge because it's a metal, and P silicon is having holes, so basically it is having lots of positive charge, and SiO2 is non-conductive. SiO2 is non-conductive. So what you can observe is that there are 2 plates. One is having a negative charge and one is having a positive charge. There are 2 plates separated by a dielectric. Separated by a dielectric, which is SiO2. So this gives rise to something called as MOS capacitance. It gives rise to something called as MOS capacitance. Naturally, because this has got some length, some width, so there is an area which is there for this particular plate, which is aluminium and P silicon. And that is why this gives rise to a MOS capacitance. And these capacitances are responsible for the frequency response of the amplifier. So that this is the reason why we are relooking this concept, because you should know which part of this MOSFET is exactly going to affect my frequency response, and is there a way in which I can do something at the MOSFET level. I can reshape it or do something like that to change the frequency response of the amplifier. Okay. So next concept is MOS capacitance. So what is the formula for the capacitance? C is equal to epsilon A by B, standard BW. So we'll start with that only. So before we go there, you can see in the MOS structure, it can be observed that the metal, which is full of electrons, is separated from the p-type substrate, which is full of holes. So there are charges which are separated by a non-conducting layer of SiO2. A non-conducting layer of SiO2. This gives rise to a capacitance arrangement known as gate oxide capacitance. This gives rise to a capacitance arrangement known as the gate oxide capacitance, and it is denoted by COX. It is denoted by what? COX. So this is something that we need to understand, that this capacitance is going to be there because of the way in which we are stacking metal oxide and semiconductor. So this is the place called as gate oxide capacitance. Please note, the first parameter that you have seen is TOX. The second parameter that you are seeing is COX. This was gate oxide thickness, and this is gate oxide capacitance. What is the unit of capacitance? Farads. What is the unit of charge? Coulombs. Okay, let's write these two lines. In the MOS structure, can be observed that the metal which is full of electrons is separated from the p-type substrate, which is full of hole, a non-conductive SiO. This gives rise to a capacitance arrangement called as gate oxide capacitance. Now, these capacitance values should not be very large, or it should not be very small also. Let's go to the next slide to have a more understanding of MOS capacitance. So you can start MOS capacitance. So basic formula of capacitance is what? C is equal to epsilon A by D, where D is the distance between the plates. But in this case, the distance between the plates is TOX. In this case, the distance between the plates is TOX. Another important thing that I wrote here is that instead of epsilon, I wrote epsilon naught epsilon r. That is, epsilon naught is 8.854 into 10 raised to minus 14 farad. Into 10 raised to minus 12 farad per meter. So in your calculator, this is constant 32. Calculator, this is constant number 32. Okay. The dielectric constant of SI is 3.97. So here, see that C is epsilon A. D, this epsilon is broken into two parts. Epsilon naught, permittivity of free case, and epsilon r, in case of SiO2. So we have epsilon naught and SiO2. A is the area of the plate, and D is the distance between the. Now, as far as this is concerned, current of view is concerned, here you understand that there are epsilons. One is the dielectric, that is epsilon SiO2 is 3.7, and epsilon Si is 0.7. So I am just putting for some. And here we will see how to actually calculate this thing. So first we start with C is equal to epsilon A by D, which is formula for the capacitance. Then I say this epsilon is of what? That is of the dielectric. What is dielectric made up of? It is made up of, but SiO2 has got some voids in between. That means you also need to consider the dielectric of space. So that becomes my epsilon. So you can see here, this formula has got area inside it, and that is why the unit is farad. We skip the area part. When we skip the area part, what will happen is, here the unit will become farads per centimeter square. Will be per centimeter square. Okay, Shubham, I have noted it. Just a minute. Karthik, is my voice okay now?
Sir, actually it's breaking.
It is still breaking?
Now it's clear, but while you detect anything, then it gets break.
Okay, let's try to hold on for some time. Please copy this right hand side, left hand. Give me 2 minutes. Okay, I think it's issue is solved now to some extent. Has it, Karthik?
Yes, sir, now it's clear.
Okay, so let's see a problem. If TOX is 500 angstroms, calculate COX. So the solution to this would be COX is epsilon naught d. So you can see here COX instead of epsilon naught is 854 is epsilon naught, 3.97 is epsilon SiO2 and angstroms is 2X. Now 500 means 500 into 10 raised to minus 10 meters, but we want everything in centimeters. So this would become 500 into 10 raised to centimeters. And so here so here, that's how I have written 500 into 10 raised to minus 8. And you can also see here, I have used this unit, which is in centimeters. So when you calculate that, can you tell me what will be the value of COX? Just solve this using calculator and tell me or post the value of COX. So why we are solving this? We are solving this because we want an estimate of if there is a capacitance which is associated with a MOSFET which is going to affect the frequency response, what is the value of this capacitance? That is what we are trying to estimate. What is the value of this capacitance? So post your answers in the chat box. Okay. Okay, Karthik has put it 7.03 into 10 raised to minus 8. Correct. Now, I will slightly, so that is correct, 7.03 into 10 raised to minus, I have just shifted that by one decimal and I have tried to represent it in terms of micro or nano or something like that. Okay. So please, 10 raised to minus 3 is micro, milli, 10 raised to minus 6 is micro, 10 raised to minus 9 is nano, 10 raised to minus 12 is pico, 10 raised to minus 15 is femto, 10 raised to minus 18 is atto, and so on. There are many things. So this is what I will write, 70.3 nanofarads per centimeter square. What is the meaning of this? Nanofarads per centimeter square. Now, what is the peculiarity of this unit? You can see, when I gave you this problem, very important thing, there was no area. No area was mentioned. And that is the reason why we calculated the capacitance in farads per centimeter square. So we said, okay, whatever is the area, I will give you the capacitance value in per centimeter square. If you know the area, just multiply this value with the area, you will get the new capacitance. So in continuation with this, now if TOX is 500 angstroms and if the plate area is also given, if the plate area is 1 micron by 1 micron and calculate COX, so what we have to do is, formula remains the same. Now here you can see there was no area. In this we have area 2. Area is present. So what will we get? So same formula. So all 8.854, all these terms will be there. Now only we are multiplying this by 1 into 10 raised to minus 6 into 10 raised to 2 into 1 into 10 raised to minus 6 into 10 raised to 2. Now this 1 micrometer is actually 10 raised to minus 6 meters. But we want it in centimeters. So we multiply this by 10 raised to 2. So that is why you can see here, I have multiplied this by 10 raised to 2. And like this, I have done it twice. 1 micron by, so area is length into breadth. So this is length and breadth. Don't invent your own unit, that is micro centimeters. Okay. So everybody should understand why I wrote here 1 into 10 raised to minus 6, that is meters. 1 micrometer is 10 raised to minus 6 meters, but we don't want in meters. We want it in centimeters. So I multiplied by 10 raised to 2. So what is this value? Can anybody post in the chat box? Karthik, Yash, that is right. Okay. Now, let me note here, this is capacitance per unit area. And here, this is going to be the net capacitance. Now, Yash and Karthik have given us these answers. Let me tell you how I have arrived at that. So the answers given by यश एंड कार्तिक आर 7.03 into 10 raised to minus 16. But I want either 18 or 15. So what I do is, I shift this by 2 decimals, 703 into 10 raised to minus 18. And 10 raised to minus 18 is called as attofarads. So I write 703 attofarads. I write 703 attofarads. Now you can see these values are pretty small. They are not very large values. And if these capacitance values are small, the high frequency response of the MOSFET is going to be better. That means we can use these capacitances at higher frequencies also. So you can use a BJT amplifier, okay, to amplify your voice signals. But in principles of communication, you will learn that there are carrier signals also, which are high frequency signals. Now, if you want to amplify these signals, then your bandwidth should be really high. And if you use MOSFET capacitances, then or MOSFET amplifiers, your bandwidth really improves like anything. And that gives us the liberty to design high frequency amplifiers. So, what is the meaning of? So, you can see two COX. You can see two COX here. One is the COX in farads per centimeter square, and other one is just in farads. So what is the meaning of these two? So again, I am going back to the original diagram, that is this one. Now in this, you can see this pink plate. This is the capacitance which is associated. So this capacitance is in farads per centimeter square. When you multiply this capacitance by the total area, when you multiply this capacitance with the total area, you get the net capacitance. You get the net capacitance. Generally, what you see from the front is called as length, and the extension behind is called as width, and the extension behind is called as width, and the area is going to be L into W. The area is going to be L into W. So you don't have to draw this, you can just show L and W in the previous diagram itself. Don't try to even draw this, it is too complicated to draw. But yes, you can, if you wish, you can show it this way. Only this much might be possible. Yes, Tanay, your answer is right. So again, a note that please note that there is no drain and source as far as MOS structure is concerned. There is no drain and source. There is only gate and body. That's it. let's go to the next part. Should I move, go ahead? Okay, I'm going ahead. MOS parasitic capacitances. So what are the different types of capacitances inside a MOSFET? So there are two kinds of capacitances. One is called as gate capacitance related to the gate, and the second one is called as PN junction capacitance. There are two types of capacitances. One is called as gate capacitance and the second one is called as PN junction capacitance. Now gate capacitances are of two types. One is called as gate overlap capacitance and the second one is called as gate parasitic capacitance. Gate overlap capacitance and gate parasitic capacitance. As far as PN junction capacitances are concerned, there are two again. One is called as area capacitance and the second one is called as sidewall capacitances. Now, in gate overlap capacitances, we can have gate overlap with the drain or the source. So that is why we have gate drain overlap capacitance and gate source overlap capacitance. In parasitic capacitances, there are three. That is gate source, gate drain and gate body. In area capacitance, we have two, drain body junction and source body junction. And then in sidewall capacitance, we have sidewall with source and sidewall with drain. So please take down this this classification. There can be questions in the gate exam or even our exam that there are how many capacitances inside a single MOSFET. So the answer to that is there are 9 different types of capacitances which contribute to the frequency response of the MOSFET. Now, out of these 9 which you can see, only 2 are very dominant. That is gate overlap capacitance, that is CGD and CGS. So most of the times we will be speaking only about the first one, that is gate overlap capacitance. So gate overlap capacitance will be something like in nanofarads or picofarads, whereas the others will be in terms of femtofarads or even smaller. So we have to worry about the first one more. So please take down this classification. I will wait for 5 minutes. You tell me when you are done by typing done in the chat box. Please note this prefix is here. Here I have written C capital G capital D, and in gate parasitic I have written small g and small d. So write it that way only. Write it that way only. Because that is the distinction between CGD in gate overlap and CGD in gate parasitic. Now, in the next slide, I will show you where actually these are present inside the MOSFET, where actually they exist. What is the physical position of this MOSFET, of these capacitances? So first, please complete this. There are two types of capacitances, gate capacitances and PN junction capacitances. Gate capacitances are slightly more dominating than PN junction capacitances. So in most of the designs, we will neglect them. So one capacitance, one MOSFET has got 9 capacitances, and any IC these days or a processor chip will have something like 400 billion transistors per core. So you can imagine the amount of parasitics. That is why in Cadence there is a tool called as RC estimation tool. So once you make the layout and run that tool, it gives you all the RC delays of the MOSFET as well as the interconnects. And that is very important because one is with respect to the frequency of operation, how fast you can process the signal. And the next most important thing is that the delay. So capacitor R into C is delay. So if these capacitance values are very high, then it will cause very large delays and you will not be able to operate the device faster. So that is why the study of these capacitances is important. So once you are done, just write done in the chat box. Now, the first one is voltage independent, and all these other three are voltage dependent. What is the meaning of that? Many times you will be applying some gate voltage to the MOSFET. So these overlap capacitances do not change with voltage, whereas the other four, gate parasitic, area and sidewall capacitances, may change with voltage, and that is why their estimation is also a little bit difficult. So what we do is we ask, what is the value of these capacitances? We say that, oh, it's very small as compared to gate overlap. So then we say, okay, then why even estimate? Just neglect them. So one of the best parts of gate overlap capacitances is that they are high in nature. So that is why you can neglect the other five capacitances, and these capacitances, they do not change with voltage. So our analysis becomes very simple. So we can also say, whatever voltage you may apply, these capacitances are not going to change, and that makes our analysis slightly easier. I can see many are writing done, but still I'll wait. Okay, Suman, Gautam, yes. Gautam, can you unmute for a while?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Gautam, you are a new student in this class?
Yes, sir. Direct secondary admission.
Okay, okay. Yeah, I have taught this class many times, so I could easily recognize this name. Anyways, no problem. So I hope you are understanding this thing.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Any other new student in this class? Apart from Gautam, can you just raise your hands just for my... Rutvij, okay, no problem. Kushal, okay. Ayush. Shubham Dalvi, are you new in this class? Okay, Kushal, Ayush, Anmol and Rutvij. Okay, fine. Okay, you can unraise all four of you. Karthik has done some analysis. The name with capital name are BSY students. Okay, but now you are no longer BSY. You are students of electronics engineering, and there is no such distinction between any one of them. I think Shubham has seen my different photograph, that is why he feels he is in a new class. Okay, so let's go ahead. Now, I have just hand drawn this thing because it's too complicated to draw capacitances. So what, how I have drawn this? Okay, I'll just tell you how to draw this thing. Okay, you draw a very big diagram, okay, so that you can show these capacitances properly. I'm showing a very big diagram like this. So like I told you, you have to always start with a P substrate. So first you will draw like this. Okay, inside this you show like this, and here you show the gate. So actually this is gate, in between there is oxide, and this is your P silicon. Now you can show some implants here, and like this, and see to it that something overlaps. See, some part should overlap like this. Mostly it will overlap. And we'll call it as N plus and N plus. And here you can write P plus and P plus like this. Okay. You need to draw this like this. So because of this overlap, here there will be one capacitance, then there will be capacitance between gate and body. So this is body, this thing is gate, then we will have a capacitance this way between, this is let's say source, drain and gate. Then we will have two capacitances here, that is with drain and body and source and body, and we'll have, so here this is P and here this is N, so there is a PN junction capacitance here. Here also this is N and this is P, so there is a PN junction capacitance. So in all you can see that there are 9 capacitances. In all there are 9 capacitances. So I am just going back to the better figure, which is like this. So please see to it that you are drawing it this way. Now in this figure, the first one in our list was gate overlap. Okay, Tanay, I think we can see it here also in this diagram. I will not use the yellow color. So gate overlap capacitances are here. So first one in the gate overlap. Now I want you all to be on the classification. Just be, go back on the classification and just see the slide which I am showing you right now on the screen. You need to be on the classification, and I'll give you some more time to write this thing, but be on the classification. So first in our list was gate overlap capacitance. In that there were two, gate drain capacitance and gate source overlap. So in this diagram, where they are present? They are present here. CGD and CGS. And what is the value here? The CGD value will be this width, that is W, into whatever is the overlap on the drain side, that is LD. This has to be LS. And here CGS will be W, same thing, W into whatever is the overlap on the source side. Now these areas are overlap areas. So if I want to find out the area of this box, naturally common sense tells me that this height here is like W and this is going to be LS. So this is the overlap on the source side, this is the overlap on the drain side, and since this is the overlap capacitance, I know COX, which is farads per centimeter square, and if I can multiply that with the given area, I will get something in farads. So the same thing I can do at the drain side as well as the source side. Next is gate parasitic. So in this diagram, where is this gate parasitic? So this is the ones which are in red are gate parasitic. Now, what is the range of these values? You can see here, maximum is this much and minimum is this. So there is a maximum and minimum range. So it can be as high as max, it can be WLDCOX, and min value will be 2/3 of max. Minimum value will be 2/3 of the max value. So I told you that this is a voltage dependent capacitance, that is why we have a min and max value. Here there is no min and max in the first one. In the second one we have min max. The third one is called as area capacitance. So that is basically your source body junction and drain body junction capacitance. And you can see that this junction capacitance depends upon the reverse voltage. And you know that the width will increase or decrease with the voltage. That is the reason why that capacitance will also increase or decrease with voltage. And sidewall capacitances are these capacitances, that is which we are making with the nearby implants. So their value is, so the formula for area and sidewall is the same, only with a small change of or a suffix of SW. So again, this is also voltage dependent. So moral of the story is, do we have to remember all these 9? Answer is no. You do not have to remember all these 9. You need to only keep in mind the first one. We need to only keep in mind the first one. So if we design keeping in mind the first one, and if we design keeping in mind everything, there will not be much difference between the outputs. So when we do our lab, our designed value might deviate from the actual value because we will take only the first capacitance and not the second, third and fourth one. Simply because their effect is very, very less. So now if you want, I'll give you a, I'll just clear this diagram. Oh. So you can draw this only the first diagram and this diagram. And then you can write the formulas for the capacitances. So if you look at each and every formula here, I'm just rubbing out certain things. Why we did this capacitance analysis? Why we did this capacitance per unit area? What was the reason? The reason was that you can see there are some parasitic capacitances inside. There are 9 parasitic capacitances. Each of these capacitances is dependent on COx. Each of these capacitances is dependent on COx. Each of these, even this is dependent on COx. So, if somehow, and what is COx dependent on? Epsilon naught A upon TOx, and this is epsilon, I'll not write epsilon naught, I'll write epsilon, and what is A? L into W and TOx. So, if we change L or W, we will be able to change COx. If we change the length and width of the MOSFET, we will be able to change COx. And if we are able to change COx, we will be able to change the frequency response of the device. So that is the reason why we are looking at this.
Sir, can you please remove those circles because it's getting difficult to draw the diagram.
These ones?
Okay. Yes, sir, perfect.
I have included this in my lecture notes, so don't worry about it. So we could see that COx depends on L, W and TOx, but out of this L and TOx is very difficult to change. So changing the length of the MOSFET is like a company level decision at AMD. That is to move from 5 nanometers to 10 nanometers or 10 to 5. It's like a company level decision. An engineer in AMD cannot take this decision on his own. Chalo aaj length badalte hai, aisa nahi ho sakta. TOx again is in proportion with L. That means if length is 10, TOx has to be at least 1 nanometer. So there is a ratio between L and TOx. So the only thing that is at our disposal is the width of the transistor, not L, not TOx. So what a designer can think of changing is only W and not L. If he or she wants to change the response. For our lab, which will be there on Wednesday, please download LTSpice. I think most of you will have that. So our experiments will be on LTSpice. So can I get back the circles?
Yes, sir.
Just to indicate where these things are. So later on in your higher courses, you can see I have drawn a structure like this, N plus. It has got some curvature. This is called as diffusion. This is called as a diffused implant. And when I draw it perfect like this square, it is called as ion implantation. It is a perfect implant, square shaped. So you can control the shape when you use the process called as ion implantation, but with diffusion it is difficult. So if you want to get rid of the overlap, then you have to go from diffusion to ion implantation. If you want that this LS and LD should become zero, then you need to change the process of making this MOSFET. So you need to change from diffusion to ion implantation. Of course, when you do that, there are some problems. So ion implantation means it uses a very accelerated beam of electrons. So sometimes there is a possibility that it may damage the crystal and it creates something called as crystal defects. So it has to be followed by one more process called as RTA, that is called as rapid thermal annealing. So a VLSI person knows all these things. And since my specialization is in device physics, I can just talk about it very easily. So that's the thing, that's the depth to which you should reach, that if I want to change COX, what are the difficulties that I will face? It is not so easy to change something at the IC level so easily. Yes, if your device is discrete, you can. Okay, so should we go ahead?
No, sir, just 2 minutes.
If you are done with this, just write done in the chat box. I will come to know that you are done with it. So a very good MOSFET will have LS and LD almost zero. A very good MOSFET will have LD and LS almost zero. So if they are zero, then CGD and CGS will also become zero. And that is the time when you will get a very good frequency response. Anushka, my voice is not clear. Okay. So you have done engineering drawing, and IC is also like a building in itself. So I'll call this as the front view, and this is like the top view of the chip. If you look at this diagram from the top, this N plus is overlapping below the gate. This is the gate. And this is that P plus which is there inside. Can anybody tell me what is the color of SiO2? What is the color of SiO2? What is the color of glass? SiO2 is like glass. What is the color of glass? Can you type in the chat box? Yes, Anushka changed her answer from white to no color. And Rutvij has put it in the correct way, that is, it is transparent. All I would say, it is colorless. It is colorless, no color, correct. So, that is exactly the reason why when you look at this chip from the top, though SiO2 is there, you can look through it. And what you will see from the top, P plus, N plus, gate, and P plus, N plus on either sides. So just for your record, this metal will be red, N plus will be green, P plus looks yellow, and SiO2 is colorless. SiO2 is colorless. Okay, so let's move on and go to the next slide. Region of operation of MOS. Again, warning, I am writing MOS, not MOSFET. Region of operation of MOS. There are three regions in which MOS operates. Number one is accumulation region, number two is depletion region, number three is inversion region. Accumulation region means VG is less than zero, that means gate voltage is negative. In second case, that is depletion region, VG is greater than zero but small. That means here gate voltage is positive. In the third case, that is inversion, VG is greater than zero but large. That means gate voltage is again positive but large. Gate voltage is positive but large. Now, most of the times we will be using MOSFET in two regions, that is depletion and inversion. We will never use the MOSFET in accumulation. But we should know all the three regions of operation, that is when gate voltage is greater than zero, when gate voltage is greater than zero and large, and when gate voltage is less than zero, as in the first case. So these are the three regions of operation of the MOS. Let us look at all these three regions one by one. first region of operation would be accumulation region of operation. First region of operation is accumulation region of operation. So you can see here that this much portion, this portion is metal, this is my oxide, and this is going to be my semiconductor. Now you can observe that body is connected to ground. I will say body is grounded. Only if body is grounded, we can apply a gate voltage, positive or negative, with respect to the gate. We can apply gate voltage, positive or negative, with respect to the body terminal. Now, in this case, you can see this polarity of the supply is minus plus, and we know that the electric field always starts from the positive side and terminates on the negative side. That is why the electric field will be from P silicon to aluminum. Now, aluminum, you should see what is the condition inside this. Aluminum is a metal, so it will have electrons in majority and holes in minority. It will have electrons in majority and holes in minority. In the case of P silicon has got lots of positive charge and it has got very less negative charge. So who is in minority in P silicon? Electrons are in minority and holes are in majority. In aluminium, who is in minority? Holes are in minority and electrons are in majority. Now, you have seen devices till now, diode, BJT or JFETs. The current used to flow because of majority charge carriers. The current used to flow in these devices because of majority charge carriers. Whereas in a MOSFET, the current flows through the device not through majority charge carriers but through minority charge carriers. Now the question is how? So you can imagine something like this. Let us say in your class or in this 44 students, I can see that the number of girls are less than the number of boys. Or in ETRX A plus ETRX B, if we see, the number of girls are less as compared to the number of boys. Now let us assume that you all are sitting in a class and you all are spread out across the class. Now if I look at a class, then I can say that girls are in minority and boys are in majority. Another example could be your local train. In that, there are few coaches for women and majority of the coaches, there are men. So if I ask you a question that inside a local train, who is in majority? The obvious answer would be that men are in majority. If I slightly change that question to who is in majority in the women's compartment, so obviously the answer would be women will be in majority in that compartment. What is the analogy that we are trying to see? We are trying to say that if the minority is localized to a certain place, then in that place the minority becomes the majority. If the minority is localized to a certain place, then the minority can be in majority in that particular place, if not the whole thing. And that is the concept on which the MOS works. So p-silicon, if you see on your screen, in that electrons are in minority and holes are in majority. However, by applying external voltage at the gate, I can bring those electrons at one place near the surface and then ask the same question: who is in majority at the surface? And my answer can be that electrons are in majority at the surface. And we can use this surface for conduction of current. So this is how the MOS actually works, not based on majority charge carriers, but based on minority charge carriers, which are localized to the surface, and at that place they become in majority. So going forward with this, the electric field will be from p silicon to aluminum. It will be directed from p silicon to aluminum because of the supply, positive to negative. Electrostatics basic, recalling something from BW. The electrons will move in a direction opposite to that of the electric field, and the holes will move in the direction of the electric field. So in p silicon there are majority of holes and minority are electrons. Therefore holes which are in majority will try to move in the direction of the electric field, and that is why the hole concentration at the surface of p silicon and SiO2 will increase. Now holes will try to move in the direction of the electric field, that is from p silicon to aluminum. However, SiO2 is non-conducting in nature, and that is why it will not allow any charge carriers from p silicon to move into aluminum. That is why we say holes will get accumulated near the p silicon and SiO2 interface, and hence this region of operation is called as accumulation region of operation. What happens to the minority holes? The minority electrons, sorry, the minority electrons are going to move in a direction opposite to that of the electric field. So electrons will move like this, and they will get collected or get neutralized to ground. So electrons will move to the ground and holes will move towards the surface. But the mobility of the electrons is three times the mobility of the holes. That means we can derive higher current from electrons than from holes, and the charge carriers desired are electrons and not holes. And that is the reason why we do not use this region of operation. That is the reason why we do not use this region of operation for conduction. For what is current? Current is rate of flow of electrons or charges. So here the charges which are present are not mobile, they are immobile, and that is the reason why we cannot use this region of operation for conduction of current. And that is also again the reason why we do not use this region or negative gate voltages for your MOSFETs. So this will not contribute to any current. Okay, so here I have written, hence holes serve no use for conduction. So please write this thing in this way. Please draw this diagram. Yes, Anushka, you can unmute. Anushka, you have unmuted, but your voice is not coming. Can anybody else listen to Anushka? Okay, Anushka, do you have a question? You can just type it in the chat box while others are writing. I'll answer that. How did we achieve VG less than zero? Okay, so that is a good question. So let us say that this is the gate and this is the ground. Okay, so my VG is connected between zero and gate. So if I connect the supply between zero and a terminal in the reverse way, it is going to be, here I am going to get a negative voltage. If I put a multimeter here and here, it will come across this, na? If I connect the supply like this, and if I measure something here, this is actually body. Here you are having your device. Did you understand this, Anushka? Okay, there is one more point I want to add to this thing, is that you can get positive voltage or negative voltage only when one side is connected to zero, only when one side is connected to ground, only when one side is connected to ground. That means if my supply is like this, let's say plus and minus, and if I tell you to measure here, I don't know whether it is positive or negative. I don't know whether it's positive or negative. One side has to be connected to zero, because to say that a voltage is positive or negative, you need to create the zero reference first, and anything above that is going to be positive, anything below that is going to be negative. I hope that answers your question, Anushka. And that is the reason why one body is always connected to ground. Otherwise, this entire VG system will fail. If we use AC voltage, then how it will work? Okay, Karthik, we cannot apply AC voltage to a MOS. We are talking about a MOS. We are not talking about a MOS FET yet. So probably this question would be valid when we talk about a FET. Yes. I am sure that you will have lots of doubts in MOS and MOSFET. So please ask questions. So in accumulation, what is happening? Holes are getting accumulated. Yes, Shubham, I am going to do that. First, we'll start with MOS and then we'll go to MOSFETs. Okay, let's go to the next. That is depletion region of operation. Now, for depletion region of operation, we can see this is plus and this is minus. So naturally, electric field would be in this direction from positive to negative. Again, I am reiterating, in AL, electrons are in majority. In P silicon, holes are in majority. And holes are in minority in aluminium and electrons are in minority in P silicon. Now, what will happen if my electric field is in this direction? My holes will get accumulated, collected at the ground. Holes will get collected at the ground and electrons will try to move. Electrons will try to move in this direction. So, holes will come here, will get collected at the ground. And electrons will try to move like this in the direction opposite to that of the electric field. Now, the problem is that this is P silicon. The problem is that this is P silicon. So, what happens is that the electrons will try to cross SiO2, but they will not be able to do because SiO2, whatever is the rule for positive charges, the same rule is there for negative charges also. So it will not allow the electrons to cross. Now, you should understand this situation. Let us say that at Dadar station, if an empty train comes on a platform and there are not much people also on the platform, what will happen? As soon as the train comes, people will go inside and sit on the chairs inside the coach. The train will start and go back. So people would not jump out of the train just like that unless their station comes. Now, the case is something similar here, that electrons are trying to move towards SiO2. They cannot cross, but they can see positive charges. Chal Matre, your microphone is on mute. So, electrons are trying to move towards SiO2, but they cannot cross. And what happens because of that is, they recombine with the holes at the interface and cause depletion charges. They cause depletion charges. So, they recombine with the holes at the interface itself and cause depletion charges. So these charges cannot move. These charges cannot move. They are immobile charges and hence they do not contribute to any current. Now, just for our sake, I have just put the formula here. QBO is minus of 2Q epsilon Si something. And this phi Fp or phi Fn, these are the formulas for that. And this is the formula for thickness. That is how thick this is going to be, that is Xd. And if this depletion charge is getting formed, how much is the charge inside it? That is given with the help of this formula. And what is the thickness of this? That is given with the help of this formula. We will be solving problems based on this formula probably next class. So here, what you need to understand is that the electrons tried to cross, but they cannot cross, and hence they recombine with the holes at the interface itself. Now, let us say that the bias is too high. Here, Vg is greater than 0, but I have said it is small. It is greater than 0, but small. What if Vg is greater than 0, but large? What if Vg is greater than 0, but large? Now, here, electric field is going to be larger than before because your gate voltage has now become large. So what happens is that when we apply a small voltage, small gate voltage, few electrons will recombine at the SiSiO2 interface, that is P silicon and SiO2 interface here. Few electrons will recombine. Now what I am doing is I am increasing the bias. I am increasing the bias. So because of that, what happens is more and more electrons are being pushed inside this. More and more electrons are being pushed inside this. Now the position of these electrons is such that they cannot recombine and they cannot cross also. They cannot recombine and they cannot cross the SiO2 layer. So for the given bias, these electrons are forced to stay as free electrons. They are forced to stay as free electrons. Underline the word forced to stay as free electrons. It is something like this, that again same example I'll take. Of empty train enters Dadar station, which is on and on the platform there are like millions of people standing. So what will happen as soon as the train comes inside? The bias is so strong that whoever is standing in front of the gate will suddenly find himself inside the train, whether he wants or whether he doesn't want to enter the train. Why? Because the bias is strong. Initially, what will happen? People will go and sit on the seats inside. But the bias is so strong from behind that people are coming inside. They are, you know, there is a free flow of people. So you cannot go and sit on somebody's lap in the train. Okay, so what will happen? You will stand in between, you will stand in the passage, you will take some place between. Now the train starts. So the position of the electrons which are coming inside is like the people who are standing in the train. They cannot go out because the bias is too strong. They cannot even go and sit on somebody's lap. So again the bias is too strong. And that is the reason why they just keep on moving inside until the train stops, or in this case I will say until the bias is removed. So we are telling electrons to go towards aluminium, but we are now not allowing them to recombine because previous recombinations have taken place and we are not even allowing them to cross. So the position of such electrons is that they cannot recombine, they cannot cross, and hence they are forced to stay as free electrons. So if we have free electrons at the surface, this thing will act as the N channel. That is why we call this region as inversion region because we get free electrons in a p-type material. We get free electrons in a p-type material. P-type material should have lots of holes, but because of this at the surface we are getting free electrons. So we say that the surface is inverted. It should be p, but now because of bias and the MOS structure, the surface is now inverted, and this inverted surface has got depleted charges and free electrons. So this plus this is called as n channel. So I will stop here today, and next class we will do problems and move to threshold voltage and the characteristics of the device. So after inversion in p substrate we get n channel. Similarly, after inversion in n substrate we will get p channel. So that is the reason why an n channel MOSFET will always have a substrate which is p type, and a p channel MOSFET will always have a substrate which is n type, because we are going to operate in the inversion region. So that is all for today. I think you will have a next class at 11 o'clock, so I will stop here. If there are any questions, I am there. Those who want to move to the next class can do so. Thank you. You can unmute and ask questions.